pen and, I shouldn't say companion, I guess, co-worker, Michael. Remember the statement that everything you need to know you learned in kindergarten, how true that was? Well, there's one added because of the Catholic schools. There's one other thing in kindergarten, and they say, why were you born? And the answer always has been and always will be to love and serve God. And sister was paying attention. So at age 16, she joined the convent. And now it's 60 years later, and she has one heck of a story about her work in Brazil for 17 and a half year in the Amazon. And it's quite a story. So here she's in the back of the States, and with her is Michael, oh, would you both come up, please? Is Michael Straughn. He's with the organization now that really ships all over the world. Unbelievable. You name it, they ship it. Now I'm going to explain it. Both belong to Rotary. Sister belongs to the Independence Rotary Club, and Michael belongs to the Lee Summit Club. So their work is great. Their work is needed, and we're delighted to have them. And thanks everybody for coming today. First, we'll hear from Sister.
I forgot to grow. Over the past years, I've begun to shrink. Mr. President and all of the Rotarians, it's a great honor for me to be here and to share my story. I know it was listed as the power of one that also can then be transferred into worldwide activities. I actually grew up in the country area and surrounded by my relatives. One time, one of them said, "We're not sure. I'm not sure what's going to happen to you, but I think you're going to do something that none of the rest of us have done." I didn't really think that much about it at the time, but later on it was, okay, none of the people in my family had ever gone to high school. And then later on the younger ones were going to high school, none of them had gone to college. And I had the great advantage of not only going to a Catholic high school, but then also going on, becoming a sister, and going to college. At one point, so that was the power of one person saying to me something that I could reflect on. I made a trip to Austin, Texas at one point in my life, and there, it went across the border to this little tiny church, and the priest said, "Why don't you just stay here? Just call your superior back in Independence and just tell her that you want to stay here and work. There's lots of work to be done here." I said, "Well, I can't do that." So, but that idea started working in my mind. And later on, our community was deciding to go to a mission. And we were choosing to go to the mission in Brazil. I didn't really feel a missionary vocation. The other two sisters did. And so I was going to go along as the spare tire. In case something happened to one of them, I could fill in. But as I actually ended up going there, I felt like I was going back home because we had no electricity, we had no running water, there was no sewer system. The difference was all of our travel was on the river. So an ordinary weekend would mean an 11-hour trip upriver, dropping off sisters and other lay people too, work in the little churches along the way, and then on the next day, picking up everybody and coming back home. Even before I went down, I had to sign a paper that said I would be buried in Brazil. Why? Because we were in the Amazon rainforest. The body had to be buried within 24 hours. There was no embalming. And I figured there was going to be no way that I could schedule my death the day that the plane came into the city closest to us. It would get me out of the country in 24 hours. Needless to say, my family was not too pleased with that. But I said, that's the way it is. So I'm now down in Brazil and looking at working, teaching, doing some missionary, some medical help with our nurse. You know, having deliveries in the little shacks, having to put the delivery or the bed in little cups of water so that the cockroaches and the ants wouldn't climb onto the bed. Witnessing people dying because they didn't even have the common medicine to take care of colds. Seeing people being crippled for life because they hadn't been bit by snakes. And so I began to look at that aspect of my life and say, okay, is it worth being down here this long? Many times I had that question of, have I done anything worthwhile? Another voice came from a dear friend who said, don't look for success. You've come from the United States where success is very important. But success, the results of your work is going to come probably 20 to 30 years later. So forget about success, just be comfortable with the present. And so once more, it was the voice of that one that calmed my fears of continuing the work that God had wanted. And then I ended up in the middle of the rice, harvesting our rice. We finished a week of harvesting rice, and the sisters in my community, I told them that I didn't know what they were going to do with the rest of the day. It was noon. That I was going to go to bed. Now for me to say that was like this bolt out of heaven, what's happening now? So they looked at me questioning and then said, no, you're not going to go to bed. We're taking you to the hospital. You're jaundiced. I hadn't even noticed that I was jaundiced. I ended up having gotten hepatitis A. Went to the doctors, came home to the States to get more testing done, only to discover that I'd actually had hepatitis B for 5 years. My tiredness, I figured, was the result of just the work I was doing, not realizing that I had actually had hepatitis B already, and the A just activated it. So I was really advised that it'd probably be better if I wanted to live any longer to come back to the States, rather than staying in the tail end of the Amazon rainforest, where to go to get any of the good supplies you would need to medicines, you'd have to go on a plane to a town that was like 2 hour plane right away, just to get the medicines we needed. So I did come back to the States. But it's like, okay, now what do I do? I've been out of the country, civilized country, for 17 and a half years. I was a teacher before I went. But to come back and teach now, I would have to go back to school again. I don't even know what's happening in the school system here. So I'm just gonna kind of play it easy. Just see what happens. But I came back with a question from the people there and a request. They said, whatever you do, if there's any possibility, send us a pallet of Pepto-Bismol. To me, at that time, I knew what they were talking about, because they had discovered on their own that Pepto-Bismol was curing their bleeding ulcers. At least that was the result of it. Nearly everyone had stomach problems, and you know, all of the intestinal problems. Many of the people had had hepatitis, malaria, constant monthly sink. But they had discovered that if they had, you know, taken, at that time it would be like several bottles, time in succession, of Pepto-Bismol, it would cure them. The problem was, the pharmacies in the town closest to where we were, a bottle of Pepto-Bismol was $20. And we had, before that, set down some in the big containers we had set while it was down there. And it's like, okay, we could give it to them for $2. So that, you know, the ones, and if they didn't have money at all, we would just give it to them. So that was the request. Whatever you do, send us Pepto-Bismol. Okay, so how do I get Pepto-Bismol down to 2,000 miles down the Amazon River? I started calling booking agents, travel agents, cargo shippers, and found the Molcan Container Company, at that time out of North Kansas City. I said, how do I get a pallet of Pepto-Bismol to the Amazon rainforest? They said, well, it's kind of risky doing it, because it has to go down so far, it'll be transported from one ship to another one, it may not get there at all. But they said, we can send, you can send down a 20-foot container, and you can put as much in that container as you want to, as long as it's not over, I think it was 30,000 pounds. And it'll cost about the same thing as that one carton. So I said, okay, what do I put in it? Where do I get the stuff I want to put in it? And so we started putting out a few feelers and saying, well, what we really need are clothing. I went to like General Mills and got flour. I went to the pasta companies and got pasta. Went to the grocery stores and got a discount on powdered milk. And that's what we started sending down. Well, then, because the container could hold so much, it's like, okay, what else can we put in there? Well, by chance, one of the nursing homes in Independence at Nurse Matter said, we're changing out all of our beds. You can have them all. Well, it ended up, at, I think it's somewhere close to 75 to 90 beds. Okay, so how do you get beds down there? The same way you get the others. You put them up on end in the 20-foot containers. You can put in 30 beds and 30 mattresses and the headboards and everything else. And we ended up helping the local public hospital completely change out their beds. Now, for them, it was a great privilege because the mattresses they were having the people sleep on was about an inch thick. It had no, theirs had no sheets on, no blankets. The people had to bring in the food for the patients. And the bed itself was really rusted. So for them, it was a great privilege now to have received the beds. So in the course of those first five years I was back here in the States, it was like, okay, we're now sending not just one container a year, one 20-footer, but we were getting enough supplies in to be able to send in, we had gotten up to 24 20-foot containers in those 5 years. Well, part of the problem was that is we didn't have a warehouse. We were having to take it in from Independence into Kansas City, of all things, in the months of December and January, because that's when we had to send out the shipments. So we're in the snow, we're in the cold, getting the stuff transported from Independence to Kansas City into an unheated warehouse so that we could get it down there in time to hit the water level on the Amazon. And at that time, it's like, okay, I'm getting tired. I'm getting older. If we're going to continue to do this much, can we put up a building on our property? So our superior, Sister Connie, ended up designing 150 by 60 foot metal building into sections that was large enough that we could store all of that we needed for the 8 containers. And with that also, space for sorting supplies. But we weren't sure the mission project was going to continue, so we really fixed it so it could be converted into conference rooms, even a small gymnasium, in case we got no more medical supplies. So that was in the year 2000. We dedicated the building. Really pleased that all of our supplies now were under one roof. We could get the containers at our dock, and we had it heated. So we thought we had it well. Sent out the first 4 of that year in December to Brazil with 4 more ready to go. And paperwork in Brazil got totally messed up. And so the bishop down there said, don't send any more. Now, I'm not a businesswoman by birth or by study or whatever, but if I'd ever come to the low part in my life, it was God, what now? We put up this building because Brazil was the only place I knew that needed supplies, because that's where I had been. What do we do with the supplies we have? Who needs them? If you let me know where you want them, I'll do everything I can to see that it gets done. So he left me in limbo for 1 month. The month of January was, okay, God, where are you? Who needs help? Beginning of February, the earthquake in El Salvador. An immediate response of, we can give you 4 20-foot containers of just household supplies, clothing, even food with it. And they said, no, that's not what we need. We need building supplies. So I thought, I don't have one. But as God would provide, people gathered around. We started getting plastic, the heavy plastic of greenhouses to send down to them. They came all the way from Canada. We ended up getting mattresses from Chicago. People from Iowa were driving in pickup trucks with all of the hammers and nails and screws that would be needed. We had a gentleman who donated a 50 by 100 foot, all of the metal work that needed to be put up that building. We put that all in containers and sent it down. And then from there, we ended up with, within 2 weeks of that, we get a request from the Dominican Republic, Ecuador, Peru, and Malawi. We didn't know the people from any of those places. The one in Dominican Republic was an orphanage that had partly burned. The one in Malawi was an orphanage that they wanted to build and equip. The one in Peru and Ecuador were both areas that were out in the country and needed supplies. Would we help them? Well, how did y'all find out about us? You know, we're just this little community of 13 sisters in what is called the dead end of Noland Road and Independence. How did these people find us? And it was, they had met someone who knew us, who knew someone else who knew us. And here are our needs. And that's how God has, I guess if you want to call it, I happen to be the one in the middle of God's road that one person that could begin to make a difference. I didn't realize what we had really done until we had our 10th anniversary. And it's like, oh my goodness. We have been in all of these countries. We have served thousands upon thousands of people. We have started clinics. We have equipped other hospitals. Many of them are maternity hospitals, maternity clinics that are, we're now all over the world. Not all over the world as such, in one sense, but over the world in the sense that we have now been to 64 different groups in foreign countries, and we have been in 10 different states here in the state itself, helping on a local level. And at this point, the power of one, I kept telling God, okay, God, you know, I'm wearing out. I'm not going to be able to do this. I'm not a businesswoman. I was a teacher. But it just kept growing what was happening. And so I said, God, please send me somebody who will be able to put our warehouse in shape. And so 5 years ago, he sent me Paul Wilson, who was a retired Army person. And so he put us in shape, began to get us everything all organized. And then I said, okay, God, I need somebody else. We need business. We have to get this business area taken care of because our requests are getting more. There's so much out there that we need to help it supply the people who are in need. And that's when Michael came up, showed up on our door. And I told him he couldn't leave until he had signed the papers. So he will tell part of the rest of this story. At one point, when people started talking about, I was the one who started this mission. Well, I could only start because of the support of my community. I was the one in the middle of God wanting to move forward. And I was asked, when I started this, did I have any dream of what this might be in the future? And looking at how much we had been able to do with just 13 sisters in the small area of Independence, doing all of these shipments, I said, wouldn't it be wonderful if in every city in the United States, all of the medical and school supplies that are being put in dumpsters and landfills could be gathered together and sent to those countries where the need is great. And so that's a part of what is our mission now, of trying to reach as many as we can with the support that we have, and really encouraging other places to join us as well. And I'll turn it over to Michael.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting us to share your lunch with you today. I have been to many of the Rotaries around the area, and I'll say that your lunch is the closest to what we have in Unity Village out there. It's pretty good. You need to come out there and try ours sometime. I am new to the Franciscan Mission Warehouse. I just came on board at the beginning of November, so I don't have a lot of stories to tell, but I've learned a lot, and I can go on for a couple of hours here, but we'll keep it short. My uniform hasn't arrived yet, but they say it'll be here any day, so I'll fit in here pretty quickly. Your theme for today is the power of one addressing fundamental needs worldwide. Is this a pretty cool story, the power of one? Sister Andrea is an excellent example, as she gives a rather humble accounting of her accomplishments. I was pleased to be invited to tag along today so I could give a little different perspective on her story. I am I come from Habitat. I run Habitat Restores in Eastern Jackson County and East Springs and Independence, doing all the numbers and looking at everything analytically and trying to get things running that way. And I come here and things are a little bit different. But to kind of review some of the things that she's talked about in a different perspective, the warehouse part of this organization has operated in Jackson County for more than 20 years. How many of you have heard of the warehouse prior to this conversation? They don't advertise, they don't tell people. They serve tens of thousands of people globally. And I put that number in there because I knew it was a big number, but I have something else to be sure. They serve thousands of people here in the US and locally. One of the things that I try to put together for grant applications and letting people know, you have to know the statistics. They've not been the greatest at recording everything. They've just helped people and said, bless you, have a nice day. And so now I'm having to go back and dig up some of those numbers and come up with some things. In 2016, they recorded over 5,000 volunteer hours at the warehouse. Since Sister started with this, they have shipped over 250 of those containers to places around the world. Now that's a lot. These containers typically weigh about 20,000 pounds. You know, and coming from Habitat, one of the things that I look at is waste and diversion. How we keep things out of the landfills and how much do you keep out of the landfills? Those containers add up to over 5 million pounds of stuff that could have otherwise ended up in local landfills that people need, people use. The two shipments that I've been involved with in the last couple of months to Ghana and to Cameroon, I've kind of gone through the stuff that we put in those containers, looked up what a retail value would be on the items that were in there. If these clinics, these places in the world had to go buy this stuff new, what would they have to pay for it? And they were between $400,000 and $500,000 worth of equipment. So if you figure an average of $400,000 per container for 250 containers, she has provided $100 million worth of support to people around the world. I know she says it's not her, but she thought this. And you know, did she do it because she had special higher education as far as how to serve people, how to do medical response, how to do those things? No, she didn't have that. Did she do it because she went to seminars, went to round tables, got with other people and learned best practices of how to do those things? No, she didn't do that. Has she been successful because she was meticulous at keeping numbers and recording who got what, who brought when things, so that I could come in and generate reports and statistics and stuff like that? No, it wasn't that. She and the people involved with her have been successful because they have a heart for the mission. They have a heart for helping other people. There are people in this area that are blessed with more than they could ever deal with on their own. And they're willing to help people, whether they live here, they live in Missouri, they live in this country, they live around the world, people with people wherever they are. And they have found a resource here that they can feel better about themselves through Sister and the mission that she does. There was one thing, I received an email yesterday from Molly. A gentleman who was welcoming me to the organization, and he gave me some information here. He says, the Malian population has started to benefit from these donations of health equipment since 2013, and which has been useful for millions of people because these sanitary facilities are located in several health centers in Mali. So I was thinking tens of thousands of people. This one group that they've been working with are saying millions of people. Again, it's a very large deal that Sister has put together here. So what else has she added? She talked about the warehouse. And sometimes when you talk about these big numbers, you may say, or form a picture in your mind that it's a nice big warehouse. You got a couple of forklifts coming and going, loading trucks and unloading donations that are coming in. You have an admin office where you have a couple people on the telephone procuring donations. You have a couple of people on the telephone sending out fundraisers and looking for ways to fund what we're doing. And you just have this well-oiled machine of everything running. We have that picture in mind too, but it's not reality yet. As she mentioned, they hired Paul 5 years ago. He's the only full-time employee, or has been until I got sucked into this. They have 2 part-time office people, they have a part-time volunteer coordinator and a part-time secretary, and Sister Andrea. And you know, my first couple of days, it was get off the forklift, get out of the truck, you don't have to do this stuff anymore. These are all the things that she did. But for all of the things that they've accomplished, it's pretty amazing that they've done it with such a small staff. And part of the reason that I've come on board here is that they have developed a tremendous foundation, a base to stand on. They have contacts with medical facilities. Not a lot, because they know that they can't respond as quickly as they need to. If we contacted all the hospitals in the area and all the doctor's offices, they would start calling saying, we've got stuff, can you come out and get it? With one person in one truck, we would say no, they would never call us again. So they have metered the people that they let know about them. But we have another truck coming next week, so we'll have 2 trucks. Sometime down the road, we'll probably hire another person to help haul in the warehouse and drive that other truck. We'll be able to respond to one of those donations. We work with organizations around the central part of the country. There are other people like us that collect materials from hospitals or doctor's offices, and some of the stuff that they don't need, some of the stuff that we need, and we have stuff that they need. So there's a very friendly cooperation between these organizations, and it works out well. We want to build that network. We want to be able to let more hospitals know about us. We want to be able to answer more requests for support. So we're having to grow this orifice that's in between the supply and demand to let more stuff through here. And that's going to be my job for a while. So how do we get more people involved? How do we get more money in the organization? And how do we serve more people around the world? And all of this is beginning before Sister Andrea started. So I'm going to end there. I could go on for another couple of hours just on stuff that I've learned in these first few months. But let's open it up to questions, and we will do our best to give you some good answers.
Thank you, Michael. Mr. Balti.
Thank you both for your presentation today and for all you do for those who need you. What difficulties have you run into the red tape bureaucracy, things of that sort, both the church, the government, or people on the receiving end of the government?
We have run into some out of the 250 we've sent. I think our number is low of the problems that we've had. 3 or 4 of them that we've actually had caught up in customs. Our policy is that we pay for the shipping from and all of the money involved in getting everything ready from our door, the warehouse, to the port of the country it's going to. It's the responsibility of people requesting the supplies to make sure that they can get it through customs, pay those charges, and transport it to their places within their country. That's where the problem comes in, much of it, because they think that they have an agent who's going to get it cleared through customs, and as in many of the underdeveloped countries, that is not always not an honest dealing for some of them, and so it gets caught up there. The ideal would be for every shipment that we send out to have someone already designated that we would designate in that country to be able to run it through customs. That would be another whole job of a person just going from country to country to country. But yes, there are those occasional ones.
One thing you brought up there sort of was, you know, problems with the church. And I'm sure many of you are thinking, well, this is one of those Catholic organizations and they got plenty of money and everything should work out for them. But one of the things that I need to get across to people is that the convent and the Franciscan Mission Warehouse are not funded by the Catholic Diocese, by any of the churches. I mean, they donate money every once in a while, but they're not a regular source of income. The way that they pay for everything that they've done is through the kindness of individuals. There are a lot of people who know about the convent, about the warehouse, not so much about the warehouse, but we know about the congregation. There are people that send $20, $50, and of course the sisters go out and they do have jobs or have had jobs, and they work that way to fund this. This is not something that's backed by any large organization. So it's people like you that they keep going. And it's kind of like, I don't get into that, but since we don't get money from a large church or something like that, they're not problems because they don't have an investment in this.
Let's see, we have time for two questions, Al and then Mark.
Yeah, St. Anne's Parish in Prairie Village, through our Knights of Columbus, we collect medical things from older people that pass on. And each year we have maybe 6 to 10 beds and other kinds of equipment. And we got two fellas that pick it up and take it out to the warehouse. Now, all of you, maybe in one of your churches, would have a group or an organization, and people don't know where to go with this stuff when their people pass on. I just came from a funeral, and I'm thinking of the stuff that could go on then and be a living gift to others.
Along that line is, not everything that we collect goes overseas, it goes out of the state, it goes a long ways away. One of the things that I'm starting to learn through the collection of statistics is that they give a lot to local people. We have a good number of home health professionals that help people care for mom or dad at home, and they know that they can come here. If somebody needs an adjustable bed, if they need medical supplies, we have a lot of stuff. And they come there, and until now it's just been given to them. They've been a source for the local communities for a long time, and it's just one of the best kept secrets in Eastern Jackson County.
Mark, just out of curiosity, sister, have you thought about utilizing your Rotarian ties in the countries where you're sending materials to help you on the receiving end for something?
Well, our shipments that got caught up in customs actually was partly financed by the Independence crew, and it was going to the Rotary Club in Mali. And the only thing we can figure out is it had to go to Senegal before going to Mali. It was going inland from Senegal to Mali. It was in Senegal, but it still caught up. So we had the district governor and another Paul Harris member of the Rotary Club in Mali, who are the consignees. And we've just been battling back and forth right now for about the last 3 or 4 months, trying to figure out. We couldn't figure out what the problem was. All we got was notice that the containers were still in the warehouse in Dakar and accruing money. And so they're supposed to be responsible for taking all of those. The problem with that is until they claim it, it's ours. And so if they don't claim it, then those fees all fall back on us. So just in your minds, get in contact with all your Rotary comrades around the world, and just maybe what would help us open up in some of those areas of difficulty with the Rotary Club and see what we can do.
Closing up real quick, we're starting some new things. We've got a new Facebook page, it's FM Warehouse, kind of like FM Radio, but if you go look for FM Warehouse, you'll kind of see what's going on. Also, we're doing a newsletter. I have a sheet back there if you'd like to hear about us. It'll go out once a month of what we've been doing. Please give me a name and address. And then on your tables, we have some brochures about a little more about what the warehouse does. We've got 93 acres up there, of its farmland and wooded area. We've got trails through the woods, and in the middle of it's a steel warehouse. We'd like to invite you all, as a group or as individuals, to come up and take a tour, hear some more of the story, and just kind of hang out for a while. And while you're there, you can hold some videos for us. Thank you very much for your time today.